we'll be having a talk about managing evolution of a software product. With us is Yevgen Kuzminov from Mobi Dev, and he'll be talking about, well, how to manage evolution in a software product. The stage is yours.
Yes, thank you. So my name is Yevgen Kuzminov, and I develop web application for about 7 years in Mobi Dev. And I participated in more than 10 projects and reviewed a lot more with my colleagues. And based on that, I want to share my advices and experience with a wide variety of listeners, most of all for product owners who could see what they could miss in communication with their development team and in visibility of their product development. And for developers, and they could see what could be improved in the technical aspect of their projects. So, in any case, success of the product is the result of plenty of work of the whole team. And I think I should start from something funny from the very beginning. But you know, and maintaining changes in projects have ruined so much lives that it is not funny at all. And I should start from far away, from the evolution. Because all we know that meaning of life is evolution, and I want to stress that product always changes. And that's an axiom. And a lot of products have started as a bright idea with some small core group of developers. They very quickly gained some initial functionality and coding. But at some point of time, they face some next big steps when you understand that your current technology could not satisfy your current needs, or your new features are taking so much time that you can't support the old features, and that all is going out of the control. So I want your products to survive that evolutional storm with my advice. So first of all, let's see these blockers once again. You would like to change technology, but you still want to maintain the same velocity of development and still want to sleep well at night. And three keys to success in this process is if you have a new technology, you need to expand your team. But finding the local developers is a very hard task for the most companies, and that's why very popular right now to take some remote development team, kind of outsourcing, and expand the team with these developers. When you will have a remote development team, you cannot just proceed with the same processes that you had before. You will need to implement new processes of communication and development, and tools will help you to do this. Now let's start from the main part of this triad. From my point of view, is the team. As Alistair Cockburn characterized people as the first order non-linear components of software development, I completely agree with this statement. And when you want to make change in your product, first of all, you need to set clear goals to say what I want to change, but not how to do this. Because, for example, when you are thinking about new technology, you should think about what this technology will bring to your product, but not how cool is it to use this trendy new tech. And you will decide technical steps with your team, but not by yourself like a product owner. A lot of project management stuff is made by some separate person, project manager. Sometimes it is on the remote team side. But the product owner always should be the part of his team. So even when product owner is not a technical guy, he's the most motivated person inside the development team. And product owner should infect all others with this motivation. Because motivation is not always because of money. Sometimes, for example, I had one project with a cool person from the Silicon Valley. We have made an entertainment application for him. And it is in App Store and successful for about 5 years. It had monetization. But this application was made his reputational asset, because the owner of this application is IT manager in different companies. And this is a proof of his IT expertise, that he's owned his own application. And the third one, you should know my business. I'm talking about the idea that even when product owner comes to some team, and he knows that this team has a great experience in some field, for example, e-commerce. And product owners think that this team will do the great e-commerce product for him too. But that's not really true, because all projects are unique. And even if this team has done some e-commerce projects before, there are a lot of differences. For example, how you do the logistics, how you do some discounts, how accounting is working exactly in your business. Because IT product just reflects your real business, and you should share all those business cases with your team to make really great products that satisfy your needs exactly. And actually, do you want an advice? How to get the motivation of your development team completely for free? You just need to be honest with them. You should share some business ideas with developers. Don't consider that developers are just writing code. When you have some deadlines, when you have some exhibitions, or you want to show your application to investors, just say it to your developers and they will be motivated by this. They will understand why exactly we need to hurry up right now. And that works and it's great. Another aspect is when you have a local and remote team, you should keep an eye on their relations, because we are all people, and at some point of time, someone from one team will start to hate someone from other team. And the more you will hear something like, the problem is not in our side, that's a great indicator that something is wrong, and you should facilitate this. And this will break the productivity of development if there will be some unresolved conflict between the developers. And another great aspect of friendliness is that when you do a collaborational discussion with your team developers, you could get some new vision from completely unexpected point of view. For example, you could not to start developing some huge module to your system and spend a lot of money, but they could make an advice to use some external service to cover these needs from the beginning of for the first implementation, for example. And based on all of these points, you should get some trustful relations, and you should remember, first of all, that not only product owner should trust his team, but the team members should trust in mutual agreements with product owner. And team is immutable. Every time someone leaves or joins the team, you have a completely new team. And I'm talking not only about some cross-functional replacement of developers inside the team. I'm talking about this team spirit and the team atmosphere inside it, and actually sharing the knowledges inside it. Okay, great. So we have finished with team aspect a little bit, and let's go to the next step. To the evolution by itself, to the process of change inside the product. I will try to describe at least some use cases that could be. It's not the only way, but for example, use case number one. We have some product that was made on Parse.com SaaS platform. About 6 months ago, it was considered as a good step to start with it. But now, as you could know, Parse.com should be closed. And our product should be migrated to another technology. Currently, we had some core team. They had very good domain knowledge of this product. But based on the technology aspects and our decision, we decided to choose a Ruby as a good language to rewrite this project on. But core team doesn't have a great experience in Ruby, that's why we introduced additional team, remote team to this part of development. And consider all these things, like rewriting the project to the new platform. We had some new design, we had some new features in our mind. How should we implement this product 2.0? Well, someone could consider that we should take everything together, make a big rewrite, and release new product once with new features and new designs, etc. But who knows what will we get in the result? I propose that could be something like this. You know, like this haters tweet. We've seen a lot of them when some product release new version, and half of the users said, "That's awful, bring me back my old version of the product." That's why I really propose to reconsider another process of making some revolutionary change in product. This is small steps. When you should start with re-implementation in parallel, a new version of the product, the new platform. And meanwhile, of course, we'll spend some months on this, but meanwhile, we will make some support development for the old version of the product. Then, at some point in time, of course, we will need to freeze old version of the product and re-implement completely everything to the new version and release it. And now, the moment of truth. Your users shouldn't notice anything. So, when you had made a big change inside your product, users should still consider that nothing has changed. And only then, you need to introduce new features, new design, re-implement old features. But do it only one by one. The main aspect of doing everything one by one is that you can roll back it one by one, because you never know what new feature or what new design enhancements will bring to the productivity or performance of your application. And you shouldn't, you should always have the way, a way back. So, another use case for such a process, we had some WordPress-based project, as you know, it's like PHP, and it was working, it had very huge audience, but our customer decided that he needs some real-time features, some background processing, a lot of new things that WordPress platform in PHP just can't cover by itself. We also considered to use Ruby, and it was estimated to be in about 4 months. But during these 4 months, we needed to experiment with new features in the old product. And that's why, when we got this product to our team, we decided to make something that is not really usual to WordPress. We introduced some composer package management, we introduced database migrations automation, automated development environment, and the main thing, automated deployment. And all of this stuff allowed us to make really stable and weak experiments on the old code base. Meanwhile, we freed a lot of resources to work on the new version and finish the new version earlier. So that's kind of real implementation of the strategy. And to recap all the things, that owner of the product should set the goals to development team, and development team should decide the technical steps, how to do this, how to implement it. When development team makes decision by itself, it gains responsibility for these decisions. And the responsibility is a great motivation. Also, when you have a cycle like planning, implementation, and support, team should always understand that everything that they do, they are responsible to support in the future. And that's another aspect of motivation. Okay, great. So even in processes section, we have talked a lot about people. So, but I propose not to rely on people too much, because without tools, we are not so productive. And the main tool that can help us to work in this process is a communication tool. We can use a lot of different tools for communication, for example, Skype, Slack, Google Hangouts, it's whatever you want. So the main aspect in communication is that all team members, remote and local, should use this tool as a main communication tool. As much communication should be done in shared chats, not in personal chats. And all decisions that are made in communication process should be transferred to issue tracking system, because tasks just can't flow in the air. You should always have an issue tracker that should be shared among all users. And another small aspect, that all developers should know the flow of the development. It's not only about the words like Scrum, Kanban, Waterfall, etc. Developers just need to know how to take the new task, what the priority of the task. Do you have milestones or iterations, etc. They just need to be familiar with the process of development. And another interesting aspect of tools is automation. Actually, I think that in any development process, we shouldn't rely on the sacred knowledge of some one person. We always need to document some workflows of any routing operation and always need to have automation of some routing processes. So now I will make an example of some real tools that could be used for some different automation aspects. I don't want to sell any tools, I don't want to sell any silver bullet. You always are free to select what is better for you, and almost every time you can do it for free or for very little money. So first thing to automate is, of course, tests. Your product should be covered with automated tests, and it's really different depending on the technology how you do this. But for tests, there are three general aspects. Is your tests should always exist, and you should be sure that all new features are covered with automated tests. Your existing test should always be modified according to the modification of the features that they cover. And you should run this test as much as possible on different stages of development. And that's really all what I want to say. About the documentation, I have told previously that you should document everything and you should share this documentation. This documentation should have a clear order and some permissions. You can also use some tools like Google Docs, Dropbox, etc. Just organize this documentation and keep an eye that the documentation is updated when you change something in your product. Continuous integration, that's an interesting aspect. Actually, it is more for developers, but product owner could also see that everything is fine when you run your automated test inside the continuous integration environment. You can also make a build of the product. And you can use some tools like Jenkins, Travis, or Bamboo. And the main thing is that you can increase the visibility of technical aspects inside the product when you add some code metrics or some webhooks or notifications for each build. That could help you a lot inside the team. Deployment is the main part of the web product, especially because deployed, it means delivered to the customer, to the end user. And this process should work automatically and should be very reliable. Deployed tools are very similar to the build tools, but one thing that is very important for deploy is that this tool should allow you to see the difference between the releases, what has changed actually, and for example, what version of the product is deployed to what server. And this deploy tool should allow you to roll back the deploys with one button click. That's the main thing that should be done. Also, provisioning is very often mixed up with deploys. And you know, another edge case, when once upon a time someone have hired some guru that have set up some servers with interpreters, databases, and security, and then all your team members have changed something in the server, have installed something, removed something, and that works fine, at least for the moment when you need to set up the same server in another data center. And then no one knows what is actually changed in the server, how it works. So to do it properly, you just need always to install and change everything in the server automatically. These tools like Ansible, Chef, and Puppet could allow you to make automated scripts for deployment and to keep track of changes of the scripts inside the CVS. Okay, so you have built and deployed everything. The next step, does your actually server works right now or it is down? Do you have any errors inside your production code? You need to know all these things to react somehow, because if you are not reacting, it could fail. So let's see the tools that could help us to make a monitoring. New Relic or Scout could make the monitoring of performance at the code level. You can see what parts of the codes are slow or what database queries are slow. And that's a very high level view on the code performance. And it's a starting point for your developers to see, to start a deep investigation why some part of the code is slow. And for the non-technical guy, it would help to see is everything fine or not so fine. Another thing, server health. it will monitor the server in general, because you can have a lot of applications inside one server. And this is very important thing to use also New Relic or DuckD or Amazon Web Services CloudWatch. If you want to plan automatic scaling of your servers, you should see how much load do they have and do you need to implement new servers or not. Monitoring exceptions is actually seeing how much errors inside your code. Such services like Rollbar or Airbrake will catch all errors that happens in your code, and you will see this in these great timelines. And non-technical guys will be able to see is everything fine or not, and technical guys will be able to see what is actually wrong. And you should always try to keep number of errors as low as possible and to react on all errors that happens in your system. Logs. Actually, logs are very similar to exceptions, and mostly all frameworks also write exceptions and logs in files. But you know what is the problem with logs that are written to the server? Because they're written in the text files, and no one ever looks in these files. So no one ever, after that, knows what's actually happening inside logs, and inside logs you can add some debugging information or some handled exception. For example, your payment system is declining some cards, and you need to know why it is declining. You will add this trace to the logs. Systems like Log Entries and Splunk will organize these logs, and you, any non-technical person, will be able to make a full text search in these logs and to trace an error precondition. Okay, that's all from my side about tools. I propose to recap everything that I have talked, that in evolution process of change of the product, the team plays the main aspect, and team requires a little bit change in processes, and some mental care, some candies, coffee, and a little bit of cool tools. So the only one small thing is left in my presentation is that you should go for it inside your product and make an evolution. Thank you and your questions, if you have a time.